absolute pleasure to chat with you all the time, but particularly special when it's album number 10, the first in, well, I mean, it's 5 years, but arguably it's the first in almost 10 of entirely new material when you think about what the last album was made up of. This has obviously been a long time coming and very personal. I will say congratulations on it first before we hear anything from you on it. It's absolutely brilliant. But just talk us through, how has this album been putting together?
Oh, thank you. Through the years, I've been releasing stuff, but somehow it's not delegated as a new record, you know, because it's not me sitting in a studio or something. But I do keep really busy, and I was planning on before the pandemic, I was planning to make my next record a third installment of the Real Illusions trilogy, which is this big story, this opus, and it was going to be a very dense record with a lot of production, and then the pandemic hit, and I just couldn't get the people, you know. So, but the lockdown for me proved to be actually beneficial. You know, I thrived, and I know that it was challenging for a lot of people. But I always try to look at things as being in my best interest, even though I don't know what that is. You know, I just say, well, I don't know why this happened or, you know, a situation, but I know it's in my best interest somehow. So when you make that mental determination, then your eyes go out to find those things that are beneficial in a particular situation, because you're looking for solutions. Like, well, how can this benefit me? And so just by doing that aligns you with finding out how.
Absolutely. Has that always been the way you've been, or was that something that you had to discover later on?
Oh, that was something that I discovered through a lot of work, you know, because it's easy to say stuff like that. But to actually do it when you're in a situation that's challenging is a practice. So when the lockdown came, I didn't feel personally affected. You know what I mean? There were compromises. There's economic compromises you got to make, you know, or decisions you got to make. You figure all that out. These are challenges, you know. But I always would say, okay, I don't know how, but somehow this is in all of our best interest, you know. Not a very popular perspective.
Well, it is interesting, because I did get a chance to speak to you in the midst of this pandemic, and you were, as you said at the time, when I was trying to, like, when's the next record, what's going on? And you had said, you know, the Real Illusions part three was, going to be on the table, you know, as well as a few other things that you had in mind. But we spoke a little bit about this, about how, you know, you've tried to look at the positives for you personally, you know, even though it's not something that you've been thrust upon you, but this is the situation you're in, you're living in the now, and you've got to make that the most of that. But I found that it's been, for artists like yourself that I've spoken to throughout this period, there have been a handful of them who have been honest in that sense, that, you know, a life on the road, a life of constantly being busy, always being asked to do this, that, and the next thing, to actually get a moment, and for you, the first time in maybe, my God, 30 plus years, that you can actually say, yeah, you're not even allowed to leave home, it's got to be a time to take in a deep breath, you know, and center yourself and see where the next move is got to be. So I've thought that it's been incredible to hear that from some artists, the honesty there, because, yeah, we know that, you know, a lot of people that are even involved with you, forget the millions around the world, but even just your road crew, all of that sort of stuff, everyone's affected and they want the live shows. But, you know, you're not being honest if you don't say that. You know, I think everyone in some way, though, sometimes they've seen some positives in this from that perspective, that it's allowed them to do this one thing or that, as long as they're financially okay, that is, of course.
Yeah, the way that it's the lockdown has psychologically affected the world is as varied as the amount of people there are in the world, you know. And some people thrived beautifully and some people suffered tremendously. This is going on all the time in the world, you know. And the suffering that we experience, well, there's two kinds of suffering. There's physical pain, which we all know, you know, and there's psychological suffering. The vast majority of a person's suffering is psychological. It's the fictitious stories in their head, the commentary that they create about themselves and the world, you know. So that's the only thing that causes suffering, because in reality, there's nothing to fear. You know, there's challenges, and they're necessary. So I, through the pandemic, yes, of course I had my challenges, you know, but I didn't suffer, you know. It was just what it was, and I actually ended up thriving, and I don't feel guilty about that.
Well, then again, it's something that you can control. It's the one thing.
Because you recognize when you're creating the problems. Now, I know that that situations are extremely challenging for some people during the pandemic. They got COVID, they're in a little apartment, or they're in the street, you know, whatever. All these things are real challenges. But there is a potential for people who are even suffering those kinds of challenges to find peace from the psychological attack on themselves that they're creating. Mm. Do you understand?
Well, of course.
I mean, we all have to figure out how to navigate these things. So anyway, there I am, and just like everybody else, locked down, what am I gonna do? And I was like, okay, you know, now I'm gonna work on some things that I've always wanted to do that I never had time, you know? So I sat down, and there was one idea that just happened. It was what I found myself working on, was the song Candle Power. Because it required some really quirky finger work. And I finally had time to work it out a little bit. So that was something I did. And I did it because I was just uploading stuff. A lot of artists were then uploading stuff for their fans, so the fans could at least get something during the lockdown, you know. And I thought that was a good idea, so I started to launch a bunch of things through social medias. I started live stream two different categories. One is Alien Guitar Secrets, where I talk about music and guitar and all these things, and another was called Under It All, where I talk more about some of the esoteric spiritual principles that I've learned through the years that have been very helpful for me. And I can kind of like bring that into the creative aspect of being an artist, a musician and stuff, and how it's helped me. So those I started doing those, and they were very well received. And then I did something I always wanted to do that I had never done. I recorded a song solo, acoustic guitar and vocal, which I've never done. And also you've never seen me do, because I never did it, you know. So, you know, like I've played acoustic guitar and sang on stage, but never just by myself. But I did this with a song called The Moon and I, and I posted it, and the response was really good. I was surprised. People were starting to feel a way about my voice that I felt, which was, it's not bad at all. I actually like it.
When was there ever a debate on that? Did you find there was a pushback when you were putting
old, how old are you, my friend?
I'm nearly, you know what? I'll be 39 tomorrow.
Okay, well, before you were listening to rock music, there was, you know, the idea of a guitar god singing was taboo. People didn't want to hear it. They don't want to hear what John McLaughlin sounds like when he sings, or Al Di Meola, or Steve Vai, or Joe Satriani. You know, they have an idea of what you are, and they protect that idea. Mm-hmm. So, But I always sang, you know. Yeah. I always liked my voice. I started to not like it when everybody was telling me it was bad. What I was hearing really was, it's bad. They didn't want me to sing.
Who was this, though?
Just fans, the peanut gallery, you know, and you know, my voice wasn't very good. It was shy. It wasn't there, you know. But through the years, I when I recorded this little version of The Moon and I, it was like a little secret, you know, and I just did it and I liked it. And then I thought, why do I need to worry about anything? I always wanted to record it's too late to ruin my career. Do you know what I mean? I always had the idea, the desire to record a record with solo acoustic and vocal. And I had a whole bunch of songs that I've collected through the years that I thought would be good for this, that work for my voice. You know, because it's very limited. In the right setting, it can sound nice, you know. Otherwise, it's not a conventional rock and roll kind of a thing. So I said, well, I got all this time. I'm going to record an acoustic record, you know, acoustic and vocal. And I started doing that, and I actually got as far as the 14th song, and my shoulder gave out. I had been experienced for about a year and a half more and more trouble with it, you know, and then finally it just said bye. And I also developed a trigger finger at the same time, so that was also perfect timing, because I didn't have anything, you know. I had to get the surgery because they were torn, and it was great that I had three tendons that healed, and I made Inviolate after that, so it healed fine.
The perfect title for your current state.
Yeah, right. Unfortunately, I tore another one over the summer, so I'm trying to figure out how to negotiate that on tour. I don't know how that's going to work, but
okay,
I'll figure it out. So then I decided just to give you a little, just to finish.
Of course.
When I got out of the surgery, and I couldn't play for about a month, and then during that period, I was in it's called a knapsack, which is like a sling. The doctor that did the surgery, Dr. Knapp, designed this special sling for people who have had this kind of surgery, and he calls it the knapsack. So there I was, you know, after 2 days of, you know, drug-induced coma, you know, from after the surgery, I finally was clear, and I got this guitar in the mail. Well, it was delivered, which was the first Black Onyx Pia.
Gorgeous.
This was such a beautiful instrument. I'm sitting there, and I've got the, you know, I can't play it. You know, I'm just kind of, I'm like, God, I want to play this guitar. And then I thought, well, I am playing it. Hey, I'm going to write a song. So it was like that. And so that was another way of making lemonade out of lemons. You know, that song, I just did it because it just seemed obvious and fun. But when it was released, I mean, the response was pretty, was really good, you know.
Because, oh, yeah, of course. And you know, and Candle Power and Knapsack, you know, they make the new record, of course. Just to touch on Knapsack just that little bit more there. Obviously, you're talking about the response, which was, is brilliant, is it deserved to be. You must have enjoyed some of the debate over people going, is he really playing that? Is this an overdub? You know, like, what parts are real, what parts aren't? It just felt like the classic the Steve Vai magic that is always surrounds your playing. How did you react to that reaction?
The same way I am now, with a little smile. I have tricks. Yes, I do. I have tricks. I am a wizard. Yes. But I played every note. And not to diminish the accomplishment, but it wasn't really that hard. It's not that hard if you have a legato style. I know guys that can play with one hand. They can play me under the table. But they just don't. They don't do it. They didn't make that song. You know what I mean? So I have a song that, you know, and it just came about organically. But the way to set the record straight, the way I recorded it, if you're interested,
please.
Yeah. the moment that I had the guitar and I started fingering it, I knew instantly that I was going to record a song. I didn't know what the song was going to be, but I saw the whole thing. Right now, the hardest thing about recording Knapsack was not even playing it. It was the fact that there was nobody here at the house to help me do anything. So everything that I did, including setting up the microphones and setting up the cameras and the everything, was done with my left hand. You know, so I had to do all that, and it was fine, you know. But the first thing I did was I laid down a mental map of what I wanted the song to be. And I knew a few things. It had to be a song that could stand on its own and not a gimmick. It had to be a piece of music, you know? And it had to be melodic. I like shred, you know? I like all that stuff. But above all else, it seems to me that I'm attracted to melody. So I always say, where's the melody? You know, so with Knapsack, that didn't change. It was like, okay, you have to have a great, when I say I have to have a great melody, what I mean is I have to have the best melody that I can make. I don't, whether it's great or not is relative to what anybody else might believe, but I have to feel like, okay, you hit your mark melodically. It's good, it's there. You did the best you can and it's effective, you know? The gimmick of one hand is an accoutrement, you know. It's a side effect, so to speak, in a way. I know it's the main attraction for a lot of people, but the melody is the main attraction always, because that's gonna keep people coming back. Otherwise, it's just a gimmick, you know. So it's the same with the Hydra, which I'll explain if you like, if we get the time. So I created a mental map, and then I sketched out the melody and the chords, because that is, as long as I have that, the rest takes care of itself. And then I built a drum track, a scrap demo kind of a drum track. And I plunked a couple of chords in on the keyboard just to follow. There was no bass, no, and just like a couple of keyboard clunks. And then I set up the camera, and I just started to do it. I had to do it in sections because I was kind of writing it as I was going, right? So it was a combination of videotaping, three or four performances of each chunk, you know what I mean? And then a couple of them I had to use a little dampening device on the neck, because you can hear the strings ringing open in a lot, and some of it, most of it I was able to control, but there was a couple of riffs that I just couldn't get the strings not to ring, so I stopped, and you know. And then there was a couple of riffs where I used the sustainer, and that's where the mumbo jumbo magic comes in, where it's like, how is he doing that? It's the sustainer. You know, and you just, you know, you got to, but the guitar that I used when I was recording it, I would do like four takes of a section and then take the best one. Now, occasionally there might be a performance that's better than the visual. So I cheat in the performance on top of underneath a different visual. You know what I mean? So, and that happened a few times just because I liked the other one of the four performances better. And perhaps one of those other performances had the one riff with the sustainer. So I used that under the performance. But I would say, as far as me connecting in the video live, what you're seeing, 80% probably.
Amazing. So when you take this out on the roads, how is it gonna be? Like, are you gonna try and recreate the magic of that video in a live setting?
Well, what I would suggest there to my fans is say a prayer for me.
I love though how, you know, just out of that, like you were saying right at the beginning, seeing that a positive and a negative. Well, I'm paraphrasing you there, but you know, like in a lot of ways, that's what it is. You know, you've had this bad card dealt, but it's allowed you to create this incredible piece of music and a piece of art with the combo of the audio and the visual. But not only that, it's now going to be this centerpiece of your live performances for well, as long as you want it to be, you know, like, and you've already got so many great centerpieces, so I can't wait to see how that's gonna be. And it's gonna be an incredible moment, because the fans know, you know, the effort that's put into this, and you know, and as you say, like putting out like that, like guys pray for me, you know, it adds a whole other element to it's more like a challenge than just a performance.
Well, you know, I've given it a lot of thought, and usually in the middle of the night when it wakes me up. Now, what I you know, oddly enough, I recorded that like, I don't know, a year ago
now, yeah.
Well, I got the surgery in December, so I think I recorded it in January of last year. And I haven't played it since. Now, here's the thing. I know I can. I have absolutely no doubt that I could tie one hand behind my back and play that entire piece of music. But it would take me a tremendous amount of time, you know, and like it did the first time, you know. Actually, it's easier. It was much easier the first time. I was sitting in the comfort of my own studio going, practicing and going, okay, now I got it. Now I got it. Record that. You know what I mean? You don't have that luxury live. So I thought about how I was going to do it, and a couple of ideas came up. One of them was to actually come out with the knapsack on and perform the song, which I think would be ideal. But really, I just don't know what that would be like. I will attempt that in rehearsals, but I think that probably I'll make it easier on myself with because of the workload of learning this show. And I may not do that, and I may use my right hand a bit to mute some of those strings that are just annoying. But I like the idea of doing it. I could play the entire piece of music with two hands with the pick. It would sound different, you know. But I like the idea of playing the whole thing with one hand, only because I know that that's what people would like.
Yeah, 100%. I mean, now you've said though the idea with the, you know, using the pick, it'd be great to hear the different versions as well, just because that's what, as a fan, that's what you want. You want to hear everything. Can I just ask you, Steve, something that I heard you actually talk about is like, what was your like first memory of music, or even, you know, the first piece of music that you feel like moved you in that way that inspired artists get?
Yeah, thank you. Well, the story that I tell is based on the question, which is what's your first actual memory of music, and it was a very profound experience for me, so I remember it very, very well, and elements of it I remember. For instance, I believe I was 4 or 5, and I'd go to my aunt's house and my grandmother's house, and I'd see this thing that had keys on it. It was like a piano. She had a little organ. You weren't allowed to touch them, you know. But one day when nobody was around, I went up to this piano and I hit a note. And I was just like looking at it. And I realized that to the right, the notes go higher, and to the left, they go lower. And I had a full-on epiphany. You don't know this is happening when you're 4 years old, you know. You just... Oh, wow. But what I realized right at that moment was two things. One, the structure of music, you know, like, oh, that's, so those high notes are here, you know, and those low notes are here, and they're combined together on this staff, and you can, and that's music. So I immediately could hear and kind of see music, what it might look like on paper. It's direction, so to speak, you know, because there was music on the stands. It was, you know, like little songs and stuff. And I always found a deep attraction to the little black dots. You know, music manuscript was just fascinating. It was like art, you know. Kids were doodling, and I was doodling notes. I didn't know what they were. I did with just notes and staffs, and I just, it was sharps and flats. It was just a beautiful language I wanted to know. And the moment I put my finger on the keyboard, I realized, oh, I get it. Oh, of course. And then the second thing that happened right at that moment, which, you know, children don't have the obstructions that adults have. They're wide-eyed and innocent and interested, and they're able to make very quick associations and recognitions, you know. So I think that's what happened to me, because the second thing that dawned on me at that moment was the creation of music. Not only now, I understood instantly, kind of, of course, I didn't understand all the academics. I didn't know any of that, but I knew that they were there. And I just got to learn, you know, it's just a language, you just got to learn. The second was the deep understanding. It's almost as if I already knew all this, and somebody just tapped me on the shoulder and said, by the way, you forgot, but I want to remind you that not only is this the construction of music, how to construct it, but within you is the ability to create music infinitely, you know, without running out of ideas, and completely the way you hear it in your own head.
Wow.
So this was like an epiphany, and it just came like that. I was 4 years old, and then I shit my pants. You know, so it was an innocent discovery, but I didn't realize that all, you know, people who have musical inclinations have this recognition. It's just something that comes in different stages for people. You got to learn, then you got to put the work in. But the work was, it wasn't work. It was joy, you know, because it's like, teach, I want to know how to, you know, okay, got it, you know. And then I just started composing like at 10 years old, you know. And so that was my first real, and there was many different, like in your life, there's many different moments that you can point to where you had little awakenings about certain things, music or whatever. So there were many more after that, different things, like when I first heard West Side Story, or when I first heard Freak Out by Frank Zappa, when I first heard Led Zeppelin. You know, these were powerful moments for me.
But it was just particularly that moment, because what I tend to find with great artists such as yourself is that initial feeling that you get helps guide your taste, your barometer, you know, your instinct for creating great music. You know, 40 years into your career now, when your musicianship level is so high, and that, you know, talk about being fluent in the language, I mean, you couldn't get it anymore. You could write something just in your sleep, you know, like, I don't mean in the Paul McCartney Yesterday inspiration sleep way, but what I mean, you know, like, you could just write it without even, oh yeah, I know that's going to work if I put that to that, and it wouldn't have necessarily any emotion, but it could still sound brilliant. How do you find that balance between just guiding through, you know, emotively guiding yourself when you're writing, and just the knowledge of knowing that that's going to work?
When you're creating something, whether it's a piece of music or breakfast or anything, the way you're feeling at the time that you're creating it flows into the product. So that's how you balance it. If your approach to writing a piece of music is very intellectual, academic based, meaning you can be very creative within the box. Do you know what I mean? That has a certain feeling to the listener. But if you have psychologically captured an emotional state of mind within yourself, and you're feeling it, there's no way to obstruct that to flow into the music, into what you're creating. So I want it all. That's my demand, and it should be yours too, if that's what you want.
Sure.
I want to know music. I want to know the academics. I want to have the intellectual understanding of it. And I also want my music to be fused with those things that I feel for it, you know? So what I try to do is I at times I've approached composing completely intellectually, where I have almost like a mathematical idea for something, and I approach it. And sometimes it has some great rewards, and sometimes, you know, it sounds just totally intellectual, which is very much like a lot of contemporary classical music, you know. It's intellectual. It's stimulating on different levels for those that are stimulated that way. Mm. But those that are just stimulated by pure emotion, the power, you know, the intimacy of a piece of music, as opposed to its complexity, and you can have both, they experience music differently. I can't worry about any of that, because everybody's different and nobody's wrong. There's not a better way. You can't. It's so insane to make a declaration that this is better than that. It's better to approach your music this way than that way. Oh yeah, says who? You know. So you're free to approach. You're free to approach it any way you want, and it's valid. So I do away with all that stuff, and I approach the construction of my music in the way that it feels natural to me at that time. So this might, we'll talk about Inviolate. If you take a song like Apollo in Color, okay? So to me, that's a very emotional piece of music in a sense, or greenish blues.
Absolutely.
You know, to me, that's a very emotional piece of music. I wanted to be really intimate. I wanted those notes the melodies to speak something. But within my framework, I also demand great academics to get that point across. It doesn't mean that it's the right way or the wrong way to do it. A lot of times what I'll do is put myself in an emotional frame of mind, and I'll know that the notes that come out of that frame of mind are going to be reflective of that frame of mind. This is just 1 + 1 = 2. The only time it doesn't work is when you don't believe any of it.
Okay.
You know, when you just think, I feel this way, my heart is broken, I'm going to write a song, but I suck at writing songs and I can't do this, and it's just not going to come out right because it's not going to be as good as so-and-so, and it's really not going to, you know, so that you sabotage yourself. Only ever. And so I try to clear all that aside, and if just approach something with the inspired idea that was at the crux of it. So we talked about Knapsack. The idea was, well, I got one hand, need melody. Song like Little Pretty, I want it, there's something dark and interesting and mysterious about that. It's got the greatest solo section I ever created in my career, and it's all melody. That song is just melody from head to foot. Apollo in Color, it's all melody. And it was performed in a way that reflected an emotional state. But the construction that's going on, you wouldn't believe. I mean, I had to write charts. I sent charts to Vinny, to, you know, Henrik. And then I you know, there's just a lot there. But on top of it floats that melody. And something like the Hydra, Teeth of the Hydra, that required melody. But it was under the guise of impossible parameters, which was playing that instrument. Have you seen the Hydra? Have you seen it?
Have I seen? Yeah, of course. What Hydra is?
Yeah, when you listen to the song, all the bass, the 7-string, the 12-string, and the harp strings are all performed in one performance. I did it in sections, but it's like juggling chainsaws, you know, because when you miss one thing and the whole thing goes to shit, you know.
Yeah, no, I think right now, Teeth of the Hydra is my favorite on the record. But just like the same thing always happens though with your records after the fourth, fifth, you know, it changes, you know, depending on the mood. You know, there's so much detail in so many of the tracks that sometimes you don't always pick up on everything on that first one. So that order can change. But I think it just sets the tone for the record so nicely. And such a beautiful melody when it kicks in. I mean, as you say, melody throughout. But,
well, that's,
you
know, the thing. It needed to. It has the appearance of novelty because of the guitar.
Sure.
But that's why, you know, when I sat down to compose the piece for it, I knew I wanted it to be heavy. I wanted it to be kind of intense, but also it had to carry that side of me that's very melodic and uplifting, you know, but the melody had to stand on its own as a piece of music, or the whole thing turns into novelty.
Of course. No, I don't find, like, at any point on the record that it had, which of course you know this because that's why you put it out, but you don't think for a second about Knapsack is a little different because you can't listen to that track now without seeing you. And you know, it's become this whole piece. It's a great piece, but it feels like it's a performance in a whole. But for a listener taking this in, it just sounds like a complete record and exactly what you would be setting out to do. There is quite a lot of extended range stuff that's going on throughout the record. Were you using the Universe on this as well?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, that was Zeus and Chains. Mm. I use the 7-string.
Nice. And any plans at all, like, to update the Universe in terms of like a new model? Obviously, you've revamped everything with the Pia, and it's just become just as desirable as the Gem ever was, and the Universe is the same. But would we ever see anything happen with the 7, like, for instance, like a 7-string Pia?
I wish I could read you the previous email I just got.
maybe I was blind copied. I don't know.
7-string Pia. No comment.
Okay, well, that's good enough. That's good enough for me. Steve, do you draw inspiration from other mediums and art forms, you know, like, you know, a film that you just watched, maybe a comic book, you know, anything like that would surprise people to know that, you know, that I just saw that film and then that inspired this track?
Well, we're all experiencing life, and all of our experiences, even unconsciously, will affect what we do. They inspire us in some way, you know. So to point to a particular incident where something consciously inspired me to do something on the record, I would say Teeth of the Hydra. And it was like 5 years ago. I was watching Mad Max. And I don't usually watch that stuff, but there was this one scene where they're going through the desert and there's this guy on the front of a truck and he's playing.
Wait, Steve, there's this one scene where they were going through the desert. That's the whole movie.
Yeah. Right. Yeah. That one scene. So, well, there is one scene where they are going through the desert and there's a guy on the front of a truck playing this wild looking guitar. And I saw that and I said, why don't people build guitars like that? But it's going to be functional and real, and it's going to be, and I'm going to write a piece of music with it, and it's going to have multiple necks, and it's going to be really cool and totally impossible, and I'm just going to do it. So the only reason why I could say I'm just going to do it was because I knew I could. And when you know you can do something, then you just have to carve out the time to do it and focus. You got to just stay focused, you know? There's nothing you can't really do, you know, within practicality. The things that you can't do are those fantasies that, as you think about them, have fear in them. So, like, you know, like when the idea for the Hydra came, there was the exact opposite. There was intense enthusiasm, and that's what's required to manifest anything effectively: enthusiasm. People think they need things in the outside world to create what they are wanting to create. No, they just need enthusiasm, because that is the engine of creation, and it will guide you to anything that you need at the right time, when the cooperative components come together. So I don't know if there's, I can't really say that I can point my finger to any other track on the record where there was a clear inspiration to do it. The inspirations always came from me hearing something, imagining something, picking up a guitar and playing a riff, and then putting it on the shelf and pulling it out later and building it. But all of those things came from an entire lifetime of being inspired every single moment, like we all are, you know. So of I can't course. Really say.
Well, I'm just pleased that these days you can stick on Mad Max and create an incredible piece of music like that, as opposed to having to climb a mountain, fast for 30 days, and can we just talk as well with Greenwich Blues,
because or screw up my shoulder, or break my finger, or
that's it. Yeah. I'm not going to ask you about any injuries. I'm not going to tempt any fate. But with Greenwich Blues, you know, again, another real favorite of mine there, you know, incredible track. You expect that, of course, you know, that when people get these new records, they go straight to track 7, because it's what fans do. With Greenwich Blues, you know, there are so many bluesy elements in there, of course, you know, but it's that classic vibe blues, which is undescribable, really, apart from that. Now, early on in your career, you were sort of saying that, you know, with the blues, it was just something that you felt like you weren't the strongest at playing that style. You developed your own vocabulary, your own way of emoting that type of feeling. With this, to craft Greenwich Blues, do you feel like that's a sort of ultimate representation of that style, you know, this melding of the blues influences, but through that Steve Vai filter?
Yeah, at least to date, because it's probably one of the first songs, besides like maybe Tender Surrender or something, that had real kind of traditional blues changes. I've always, you've never heard a 1-4-5 progression on my record, and you never will. You know, the other people do it much better, and I prefer to listen to them than to do it myself, you know, because when I said I'm not really a great blues player, what I mean by that is I'm not really an authentic blues player. I've avoided that both naturally and consciously, because it's not that I didn't like it, but I just never felt good enough to sound authentically blues. Does Steve Vai want to sound like Stevie Ray Vaughan on Greenwich Blues, or like Steve Vai? You know, I can't sound like Stevie Ray Vaughan, which might be considered more traditional, authentic kinds of blues guitar, rock guitar playing. But the blues was always, I should say rock blues was more at the foundation of my musical evolution, because I learned the blues scale first. And that's what I use all the time. I just move it around and I change certain notes to match chords, you know, and stuff like that. But that's what's on my mind. If I'm thinking patterns or scales, that's home. But my musical palette just enjoys different tensional music, you know, music with a different tension. And oddly enough, Greenish Blues started out as a jam in a sound check on the last tour. Because every day in sound check, we have a policy that the band sound checks, and then I come to the stage, and my guitar is hot, ready to go, and I pick it up.
Thank you, buddy.
I pick it up and I start playing. I don't know what I'm going to play. The band doesn't know, and we record it. And at the end of the tour, I listen through. It was hundreds of these soundcheck jams. And some of them are real crap, you know, but some of them are really good. And yeah. I heard Greenish Blues, and it just happened. And it wasn't recorded properly. It was recorded like two-track. As opposed, he just happened to not hit the multi-track record. So I just got it on two-track, but I'm listening to it. And the way that the song turned out on the record, I, you know, obviously re-recorded it, but I fashioned it virtually 80% of it exactly around what I played, what I improvised in the sound check, because I couldn't believe it came out nice. You know, it was one of those moments that you can hope for. But then I crafted it, like you said, to be very Vi. Because when I'm, and what I mean by that, it's not to be pretentious. It's just to be very much in line with my musical sensibilities. I crafted it. And when I craft it, I sit and I think, okay, I'm gonna do this, but where, there's a little thing that goes on in a musician or anybody when they're in that deeply creative mode where they give something their note, they give something their intention. So for me, that includes just certain, like that comes with a riff, a particular riff, or a particular string of things. When I craft a note, I charge the note with my intention, and that comes out in the way that it's played, the touch that I have, the string that it is a part of, the tonality, the, you know, all that stuff. I don't just blow this stuff out. You know, a lot of it I do, but a lot of times I sit and I think, okay, there's the riff. How do you make it more special? How do you make it more personal? How do you make it so that you know you did something, that every note matters? Do you know what I mean? Every note. And like, for instance, that's why I said, for me at least, the song Little Pretty, that guitar solo, it's the height of my melodic creativity to this point. That's my feeling. And boy, I loved doing that solo. I loved working on it and making it just right, you know, just all the right things for me. And that's all you can really do. That's your best bet. Your best bet is to not try to second guess what other people are going to like. It doesn't work.
Well, congratulations on the new record and for giving us some more time, Steve. It's been an absolute pleasure. Please, genuinely, I think you've got a fantastic voice. Please finish that acoustic record.
Thank you. I'm going to try. And, cheers, brother. Take care, Jonathan.
Thanks, man. Bye-bye.